Okay, students, now we will move on to the last part of the structural part of this, that is the structure of graafian follicle. After that, I will give you one structure of sperm and we will finish the class. Anyway, the classes you will have to practice only, it will take time for you. Although I have done it in half an hour or 1 hour, you will have to learn it for 2 to 3 hours in a day. Otherwise, it will not be so easy for you, because drawing, sit and practice, practice, practice. Otherwise, in examination, you can't do trial and errors, right? So, now I will give you the structure of graafian follicle. Okay? What is graafian follicle? It is the mature ovarian follicle. Already we have discussed about it. From the ovary, the ovarian follicles will convert to graafian follicle. Let's begin with the structure of a graafian follicle in diagrammatic way, not a real beautiful, means beautification we need not do, just a scheme like thing I am giving you. So graafian follicle, one of them I am drawing here, need not be very round and all, you can make it little oval also, it's fine, right? It has three layers. Outermost layer is this, what I am drawing, it is called theca externa. This is the outermost layer, theca externa. This is made up of number of cells that are spindle shaped. Remember, I am drawing spindle shaped. You can draw it roughly. You need not be very, very specific in this. You can roughly draw such structures. This is a graafian follicular outermost layer that is called a theca externa. Okay? But remember, students, it takes a lot of time from you if this question appears in examination. You have to take this up only when there is time for you. You don't just try it in between or starting only you are drawing this diagram. It will take huge time and you will be left with no time for the real questions you want to draw. Okay, this is the outermost layer called theca externa. Then I will draw theca interna, the second layer. Okay, this is the theca interna I am drawing. Second layer I am drawing, theca interna. This contains number of blood vessels, highly nutritious it is. Lot of nutrients will be supplied to this area. This is theca interna. Whatever I am drawing are the broken blood vessels. Okay. The first outermost layer I am drawn is the theca externa. This layer is called theca interna. These are the broken blood vessels. Broken blood vessels. See, whenever you are drawing, as much as possible, continue to draw and write together. Otherwise, it will take a lot of time for you to separately label. Without labeling, the diagrams have no importance. You have to draw, label, and then only think. At least you write this much around, you forget in advance, at least 1-2 marks you may get it. Therefore, don't leave the diagrams without labeling. So, theca interna, I am going to show one more important thing here. It is, they are very compactly arranged cells. Right, you can see here, I am just drawing very compactly arranged cells. So, make the drawing little simple. So, that's the reason I am showing you how to draw also. Because most of the time, if I put one chart here, then you will not know how I finished that drawing, how long I took the time, what is the time required for that. And you will do the same mistake in main examination, you will be drawing. And you will not get time for other questions, right? So you draw and show the nucleus, and you can see roughly I am showing. I am not very particular in drawing all the dots and all that things. If you, this much you write is enough. Only thing what you should get it is compactly arranged. That's all you should get it. The person, when you are learning this, you should know that it is compactly arranged. But very important thing is the next layer. We call that as the membrana granulosa. That's a very important thing I am just showing you. Inner layer, this is called membrana granulosa. This membrana granulosa is folded inwards like a hump. You can see here. This layer is membrana granulosa consisting of some cells. So all these are the cells of membrana granulosa. You have to show them at least few layers. That's enough. Later, but you have to fill this up. If you get time, you can fill it. But otherwise also, just few cells, you just fill it up here and there, but label them. Very important. This is called membrana granulosa. this granular membrane. So as much as possible, finish drawing these circle things, because they are having granular cells. It takes a lot of time, as I already told you, it takes a lot of time to finish the diagram, complete the diagram. Therefore, this half at least you just show and label them. It's enough. If you get the time and then you come back and finish the drawing of these dots. So whatever I'm drawing, this membrana granular cells are entering into this. This inward projection, you can draw it a little wide also, this inward projection of this, and it will produce an egg over here. Here is an egg present. This is egg, right? So surrounding this, these are all membrana granulosa cells, and egg is produced within this. Okay, can make out here. This is the egg, right? And this portion, which is actually inward projection of membrana granulosa, is called as cumulus oophorus. Oophorus, or another name is there, it is called discus proligerus. That's an inner projection of the membrana granulosa into the cavity. Now, the word is this cavity. This is a cavity of graafian follicle, and it is called as the antrum. Remember, don't do cross labelings anytime. One about the other, don't label them. This is called as antrum. Antrum is a cavity of graafian follicle. This is filled with the liquid. We call it as liquor folliculi. Folliculi. Very important word. This you have to remember. Right? And what other important thing I left is, this is the one. This is nothing but the egg. The female gamete or the ova having haploid from its own number. So this is the total structure of graafian follicle. Graafian follicle is a final question to you. And it is nothing but a mature ovarian follicle. How to explain this? It's a mature ovarian follicle. And it is almost circular in shape. Not exactly a circle. You do not use a compass at all. You can just have a freehand round circle. Right? But draw a bigger one, don't draw very small, because still some more small things you need to draw. Right? The layers of graafian follicle: theca externa, theca interna, membrana granulosa with the central cavity antrum. These are must. Theca externa having follicular cells that are almost spindle shaped, and some of the cells will be left out also like this. This is less supplied with the nutrients. Therefore, this area is not very particular, it's a very dried up area. Then come theca interna, having compactly arranged cells which are having number of blood vessels are broken and highly nourished. So this theca interna, where I have written theca interna, is very important because it will secrete one hormone. Its name is estrogen. Estrogen is a hormone released by the graafian follicle theca interna. Okay, remember this, because many a time this question has been asked, from which part of the ovary estrogen is released. Estrogen is released from the theca interna part of the graafian follicle. Then comes the membrana granulosa, granular membrane, which is projected into the antrum, and the projection is called cumulus oophorus or discus proligerus. Okay, then at the projected portion, it will produce an egg will be pinched off. Means, you imagine one ball, from here one more small rounded thing will come out like this, top up like this, budding. That is exactly egg cell. Egg is released from the graafian follicle like a budding, right? It will be ruptured from this. Okay, this structure is very, very important for you in examination. The practical also, they will focus one slide with the graafian follicle and ask you to identify which stage it is, what are the parts of that. Okay, so just continue to draw this diagram also, because initially there are a lot of diagrams, later there is only explanation. It's only structural portions you have to draw, and lots of drawings are there only in the first part. Later part you have only process. Okay, so I want you to pause it and draw it and then practice it. continuing the previous subject, that is about reproductive system, we have learned. But all other things we learned is the gametogenesis, that is a process we have begun with. The process include spermatogenesis and oogenesis, which I already explained you. The spermatogenesis, oogenesis difference can be asked for 5 marks. This already I have given you, around 4 to 5 points I have given you. Okay. Now, apart from that, what you have to learn is the structure of gametes. Now, today I will be explaining you the various gametes formed in both males and females. Even in graafian follicle, I just explained you how the graafian follicle look like and when where is the egg located, right? Now that was the previous thing I explained you. Now we are going to talk about the structure of a sperm and structure of egg, right? So let me begin with the structure of sperm. Okay. So begin with the structure of sperm. Understand the diagram how to draw it. Human sperm is a tadpole shaped haploid motile male gamete, right? So how it is tadpole shaped? Because it has a tail. So learn how to draw it. The sperm structure, you will have to draw one head which is somewhat pear shaped, then a small constriction here, we call it as a neck region, then it will be elongated, this we call it as the body or the middle piece, then it will terminate with a long thread like tail. Okay. This is the overall structure I have given you. Now let us fill up the various things in this. The first thing in the head I am talking about. So head, you can see this is the head portion. Okay, this is head. And this small portion is called as a neck. This we call it as the body or the middle piece. So both the names you have to remember. It is also called as middle piece. Okay. Then this last portion, whatever I am drawing, is a tail. Okay. So let me give you the details of this. In head region, at the tip, there will be a small sac-like structure with number of lytic enzymes. Right? As soon as I draw, I will be giving you the labelings also, because just simply you write and it has no meaning. So this part is nothing but acrosome. Acrosome is the first part. At the tip of the head it is present. Then comes the male gametic nucleus. So remember the male gametic nucleus I am drawing here. This is a male gametic nucleus having paternal set of chromosomes. It is haploid in nature. This is the male gametic nucleus, or just nucleus I am writing, or the gametic nucleus. Okay. Now below this you find one small centriole which is almost indented with the nucleus, almost joined with the nucleus. Right? Then this will be at the neck region, there is another centriole, we call it as the distal centriole. So male, this is a nucleus. This is called as the proximal centriole. Proximal centriole. And the one which is at the neck, it is called as the distal centriole. Okay? Then distal centriole give rise to a long thread like structure that runs throughout the body and the tail. Remember this, you have to draw it in the center. And at the end it will be free. It will be like this. Okay. So what is this? It is called as the axial filament. Remember this is the axial filament. Filament. Okay. Then surrounding the axial filament in the body part, you find number of ribbon shaped structures. You remember them. You draw them like ribbon, like they are curling around this, like this. These are the mitochondria. Very important thing, you have to draw these mitochondria surrounding in the whole of the body, middle piece. Okay? These are mitochondria, and you know how to draw mitochondria. It will be having cristae and it will be having the regular outer covering. Means one single mitochondria if you draw, it will be like this, right? It will have, these are cristae and this is the matrix. Same way, you have to explain or draw the details in that. So you will be wondering what I am drawing in between. These are the mitochondrial cristae I am drawing, right? Don't draw just one ribbon like structure. These are all mitochondria, so mitochondrial cristae has to be drawn in between. These are the inner membranes of the mitochondria, what I am showing here. This is the mitochondria. We call these mitochondrial rings in the body part of the sperm. These are called as Nebenkern. So, I think you are clear with this. These are called as Nebenkern. So, one question will appear in main examination. What are Nebenkern? Nebenkern are the mitochondrial ring like ribbon shaped mitochondria present in the body part of the sperm. Why they are present in the sperm's body is they provide energy. You know already mitochondria are called powerhouses of a cell, right? So these will provide energy for the sperm. What for they want energy? Because once the sperms are releasing the female genital tract, they will have to move and reach the egg. For movement, they require energy. That energy is provided by these mitochondria, or we call them as Nebenkern. So therefore, Nebenkern are the mitochondrial ribbon-shaped mitochondrial rings present in the whole of the body portions. So because the body contains the number of Nebenkern over here or mitochondria over here, the body part or the middle piece is called as the engine room of sperm. Engine room because it is providing energy. It will help like an engine to drive the sperms. Therefore, it's called engine room of sperm. Then come to the end portion of this body, you will get another centriole. We call this as the ring centriole, or we call it as the Jensen's ring. This is the ring centriole. Okay? And the tail portion, see, actually ring centriole indicates the end of body and the beginning of the tail. Then one part of the tail you can see is covered with the protoplasmic membrane. We call this as the main sheath or main part of the tail, and the last part is called as the end piece or end part of the tail. Right? Together it is called as a tail. Right? Now let us learn the details of this. This is a 5-mark question to you. What they will ask you, examination, the same thing, whatever I say, you just write it down at the end of every book. Whatever you are taking down the notes at the end, you just mention that 5-mark questions, 1-mark question, 2-mark question, like 3 pages to read. As soon as I give you the name of the questions, you keep on writing over there. Like already I have given you some. At the end of this, I will explain you some of the questions also which are asked on the board till now. Okay. So what is that 5-mark question they will ask you with a labeled sketch? Explain human sperm. That is the question. Okay. What you have to do is first, what is sperm? Sperm is a male gamete which is haploid in nature and it is motile, tadpole shaped structure. So define it, sperm is a male gamete containing male or paternal set of chromosomes which are haploid in nature and it is a tadpole shaped structure and it is motile. Now you begin with the structure. The structural details. What you will write? Draw the diagram first. What are you going to draw? First you mention the 4 parts. Like sperm head, neck, body and the tail. 4 parts are very important. You have to draw them. Okay? Then afterwards you start filling up the details. Head should be pear shaped. Draw the head. It should be pear shaped. And at the end, the tip of that there will be acrosome or acrosomal vesicle we call it. It's a small cap like structure containing lytic enzymes. So remember that what acrosome contains. So acrosome consists of mainly the lytic enzymes. Lytic enzymes are mainly, this is the first point to remember in this. Because everyone, you need to in every part you remember some points which will be asked as 1 or 2 more questions. So lytic enzymes present in the sperm tip in the acrosome are hyaluronidase and acrosin. One more is sperm lysin. So three enzymes are there. One is the hyaluronidase, second is acrosin, third one is sperm lysin. What is the use of this? Always, anytime when you draw the diagram or whenever you label, then you will have to know the significance of that part. Right? Head always should be larger and this should penetrate into the egg during fertilization. Whenever it has to penetrate into the egg, when I draw the egg, I will show you that egg has certain thick membranes around it. The thick sheath present around it. Those sheath have to be smoothened first. Means they have to be made soft. Otherwise the sperm cannot penetrate into the egg. Therefore, to do that work, that is smoothening of the egg membranes, these lytic enzymes help. Right? The sperm lysin tip of the sperm will be broken open or it's broken down by releasing of sperm lysin. Then once the tip is broken down, all these two enzymes are released. They come on the surface of the egg and smoothen the egg membranes so that the sperm will easily enter into the egg. Otherwise sperms, many sperms will be attached into the egg. Hardly one will enter because at the right time it has to release the enzymes. Then we can have a way to enter into the egg, right? So this is about the acrosome, very important function. What is acrosome? What is its function? Acrosome is a small sac-like structure present at the tip of the sperm containing number of lytic enzymes. Actually, these lytic enzymes are present in lysosomes because it consists of large number of lysosomes produced by the Golgi bodies. So inside this actually get large number of Golgi bodies and lysosomes. These lysosomes secrete these enzymes. Like that's the depth of this. Because those depth you can expect in neat portions. But in your bold portions also you should at least name them. Right? Then only your explanation become little different. Otherwise everyone will write all these parts. Then coming to the next one. I'm sorry. It's a nucleus. Nucleus is the large part, major part of the head is containing or it is filled with the large male gametic nucleus. It is haploid in nature, containing paternal set in the male setup or male parental chromosomes. In haploid set, n number of chromosomes. Haploid because during, I told you, during the spermatogenesis, there will be reductional division where paternal set of chromosomes will be in haploid condition. If it is not only 23 in human beings, then this will be carrying the male genetic character to this or male genes in this. Then comes proximal centriole. This is the centriole found just beneath the nucleus and almost get indented with the nucleus. Then comes the distal centriole, which is found exactly in the neck region. This distal centriole produces or it gives rise to one long filament called as axial filament that runs throughout the body and the tail. Then comes the next portion. These are the mitochondrial rings. The ribbon shaped mitochondria surrounding the axial filament throughout the sperm body, they are present. These rings of mitochondria, normally they help in providing energy for the sperm motility. Because sperms, when they are left in the female genital tract during ejaculation, they need to move to the female gamete, that is egg, to the fallopian tube. Therefore, they require energy. That energy is given out by these mitochondrial rings. They are called as Nebenkern. This is another important question. One mark they will ask you, what is Nebenkern? Nebenkern is nothing but the mitochondrial rings present in the body region of the sperm or the middle piece of the sperm that provide energy for the movement of or motility of sperms. Okay, these are all mitochondrial rings. Then coming to the end of the body, body should be smaller than the head. Don't draw bigger body than this head, because only head will enter into the egg. Along that body will be taken, carried through with the same opening. Right? If the body is bigger, then head will not carry the body at all. Therefore, draw the head bigger than the body. Right? It should be wider compared to body. Right? So the body is this. End of the body is demarcated by ring centriole or called a Jensen's ring. Then it continues in the form of tail. The first part of the tail is covered with the, it's called the main portion or main piece. It is covered with the plasma membrane, protoplasmic sheath, and the end portion is naked without any membrane. It is called end part and end piece together. It is called the tail. Okay. So this is the done. This is the thing you have to learn, understand. This drawing is again, I told you most of the drawings are very important in this chapter because its weightage is more in your syllabus. Therefore, you know, one male reproductive system or female reproductive system are two important things, one mammary gland, and next is spermatogenesis, oogenesis, and the structure of sperm, structure of the egg. These are to be like at your fingertips. Anytime you draw, right? Think, okay, this is how it should be. Right? Anytime at any examination, you will get such questions. Because proof is, go through the previous examination papers, these questions are already there. Okay? So just draw the diagram, understand, and how to finish this drawing and how to explain this. Okay? So the tail function is, it helps in directing the sperm. Because it is shown in different direction. The direction is given by the tail portion of the sperm. Okay, so draw the diagram. I kept it for 1 or 2 minutes. Just go through, pause it, and draw it, practice it. Students, now we will begin with the female gamete, that is egg. So in explanation of egg, I will give some other things also. Okay, but anyway, first we will start with the egg of humans. Right? So, I will give you the structure of a human egg. Okay? So, how you have to draw this? First, let me draw one. Always, whenever you draw a bigger diagram. Whether it is 2 mark question, 5 mark question, draw big diagrams. Okay? This is the egg. Almost circular or oval shape you draw. And no need not to use your compass. Just see how I am drawing. Right? Not because of this anything artistic thing, just draw, practice drawing, right? This is the egg membrane. Egg membrane, we call this as ulemma, right? Always it's called the egg is ova. Its plasma membrane is called ulemma. Next is, above this you find one more membrane. This is the second layer above the egg. This is called a zona pellucida. See, two layers I told you, this is ulemma, this is zona pellucida. Then inside this you get the female gametic nucleus, large one having female gametic or maternal set of chromosomes, the nucleolus. Okay? And you get in humans the cortical granules are formed. Cortical granules are in the cytoplasmic granules or the cortical granules. As I told, this is a human egg, there is nothing else, yolk and all will not be present. Thus, there will be cortical granules present here in the protoplasm or the cytoplasm. Then outside this, you find highly ruptured membrane, highly awkward size shaped membrane. You can see this. This is nothing but the follicular layer which was attached to this during ovulation. This is the one. We call this as corona radiata. Corona radiata, it will be having number of follicular cells remaining attached to this. These are all follicular cells that are haplozygously present here. You can see this. Okay? This is how you should draw. This is the corona radiata. See? One very simple structure it is. Remember this. Okay? This is corona radiata. One or two such cells or some few cells you should finish drawing, otherwise this will look like some, many of them they will write like one sun having some direct lines on this. These are not lines, these are the follicular cells that are released or attached to this. This is the structure of human egg. Outermost portion I told you, this is named as corona radiata. Then the next layer is called as zona pellucida. Then the innermost layer is called as ulema. That's a plasma membrane. And this is cytoplasm. We call this as ooplasm. These are the granules. This is the female gametic nucleus. Female nucleus. Again, it is haploid in nature. So these are the parts. Very simple diagram. If it is asked, it's very easy to draw. Right? So corona radiata looks like this radiating margin because it's a graphene follicle round thing. From there, this egg will be pinched off like this. It will come out. That time, all the follicular cells remain attached to the body and all. They look like this. They don't have any particular shape. No, normally, I see students make mistake drawing like this, like this, like this, like this. This is wrong diagram. Right? Don't draw like this. Draw it. Somewhat, it's like ruptured membrane. That is called corona radiata. Then comes the zona pellucida. It's the primary egg membrane. Then comes ulema, also is a primary egg membrane. Then ooplasm, the cytoplasm, then the female gametic nucleus. Now, one thing I want to explain to you, in human egg, there is no yolk. Therefore, we call the human egg as a lecithal egg. Remember, a lecithal egg, because there is no yolk. Why? Already we have discussed it. Why? Because human egg need not to nourish the embryo once it gets fertilized. After fertilization, the placenta is formed with a maternal tissue and along with the placenta fetal tissue that will nourish the growing embryo. And apart from that, one more thing I explained just now is the primary and secondary egg membranes, right? So little bit I explain you what is primary and secondary egg membrane here. So egg membranes, this is a bit of details. You can take it as a neat portion also. Egg membranes. Egg membranes are classified into three types. First one is called the primary egg membrane. Second one is called the secondary egg membrane. Third one is called the tertiary egg membrane. So primary egg membranes are those egg membranes that are derived from the egg itself or the ova itself. Egg will only produce these membranes. Primary egg membranes. For example, it is the ulema. Ulema is primary egg membrane. Even zona pellucida is a primary egg membrane. Okay? But secondary egg membranes are those egg membranes that are derived from the ovary or ovarian follicle or graafian follicle. Within the structure, not by the egg, anything nearby that. Right? These are derived from either ovary or ovarian follicles. Not by the egg. They are called secondary egg membranes. Here in humans, the secondary egg membrane is corona radiata. Corona radiata, I have already given you. Radiata. This is the secondary egg membrane which is formed by the graafian follicle itself. But what about tertiary egg membranes? Tertiary egg membranes are produced and even, secondary egg membrane, corona radiata in humans is right. Another one is the jelly coats. Jelly coat of frog. In frog, there are number of jelly coats formed by the total ovary. It produces a lot of jelly coats around it and it is releasing. Because in frog, the material gem is external. Right? In other part, when we learn about we are learning about the reproduction in other organisms. Then you need to understand this also. What is that you have to understand? That part also I am combining here because when there is a concern, along with that we can finish this off. In France, female frog will be releasing the eggs in the form of small bundles of 200 to 300 eggs in which are bundled and packed by the jelly coat. So they will be released in the bunch. And as the eggs are released, they will be attached somewhere. These outer membrane or the jelly coats are formed in the ovary itself. That is also secondary egg membrane. But there the purpose is different. The major purpose of the frog to produce the jelly coat around it is for its protection. Because eggs are released in water. Sperms also will be released in water. Fertilization happens in water. That's why we call it external fertilization. In humans, fertilization happens inside. But here, secondary egg membrane is produced because the egg is released from the graafian follicle like a budding. It will take out, it will break down the membrane and comes out, so it is attached to this. So understand why are, how are they formed. In frogs, jelly coat is formed for the protection, because once the egg is released, all the eggs are released. We call it as spawning. Once they are released, they are in extreme environment. Maybe temperature is low or very high, there may be some other problems, pH of the water may affect them. Therefore, it is a protecting layer for the frogs. But in humans, it is just released because of the graafian follicle stored and attached. Therefore, it is secondary egg membrane. Then come to tertiary egg membrane. This is the membrane formed from other part of the reproductive system. Means it is neither ovary nor the egg. It is formed anything other than the reproductive system. For example, in frogs, it is formed by the cloaca, right? It is formed by other parts than the reproductive system. And in this one, I told hen or birds, egg, when it is passing through the cloacal aperture, cloacal area, there will be a thick calcareous shell is produced around the egg to protect it from the hot environment of the cloacal area, because environment in the cloaca is very high temperature will be there in birds. So to protect it from that particular heating problem, it will form a thick calcareous shell. So tertiary egg membrane example is the calcareous shell. Okay, so this is the extra thing I gave you for, apart from your regular egg. So what we will learn now, in human egg structure, how it appears, what are the parts. Apart from that, extra thing what I gave you is about the egg membranes. Egg membranes are classified into primary, secondary, tertiary egg membranes. This is about NEET or any AIPMT, little depth I am going to, right? Otherwise, separately if I take them again I have to give this background. Therefore, I am giving along with this. So primary egg membranes are formed by the egg itself or the ova itself. For example, ulema or the plasma membrane of the egg. Second is the zona pellucida, again formed by the egg itself. These two are the primary egg membranes. Even in fact, there is something called the vitelline membrane formed. Vitelline membrane is formed. So we can add another example of primary egg membrane as a vitelline membrane. Then comes the primary egg membrane, that is ulema, zona pellucida and vitelline membrane. Secondary egg membranes are formed by the ovary. The ovary only will be producing, for example, it is corona radiata in human egg and jelly coat in the frog egg. Then tertiary egg membranes are formed by other parts other than the reproductive structure. For example, it is in birds. In birds, there will be cloacal aperture which is producing a lot of, it will be very hot. To protect the egg from the cloacal aperture's heat, there will be calcareous shell formed. So whatever you get it in the hen outer layer, it is a calcareous shell formed in the cloacal aperture, cloacal area. This is the calcareous shell. So that's a tertiary egg membrane. I hope you got an idea. Now we need to draw this diagram. Very simple diagram. It's a 2-mark question in main examination, board examination. Draw, label, human egg. It's a very simple one also, right? Compared to this one, this is a very easy diagram to draw. Okay, just note it down. Note those points also as need points. Then here also, so many things I told you, that human egg also board question, the main diagram. Okay, then afterwards we'll start with the some of the 1 and 2 mark questions. Dear students, let's continue with this about the process of reproduction. Very important thing I want to give you now is about the menstruation cycle, menstrual cycle. So what is it actually? It is the total cyclic changes happening in the female during the formation of female gamete. So female gamete formation is the cyclic process. which is around 28 days cycle it is. It involves total change in the complete female reproductive system and reproductive organs. Very important is reproductive structure, and all the reproductive parts will get structurally and functionally they will change. That's for the menstruation cycle or menstrual cycle. This is a very important 5-hour question, because the whole thing is governed by various hormones. And here you are not supposed to only learn what's happening. Along with that, you are going to learn the hormone changes, the production of hormones by the pituitary, hormones produced by the ovary, what happens in the uterine wall, and what happens in the graafian follicle. All the females' whole cycle is like a machinery. It operates on its own. Normally females will not even analyze what's happening with them, because normally the hormones are continually producing whenever the females are at the menstrual cycle. I hope already you know it. Menstrual cycle is the cyclic changes happening in the females during the female gamete formation of the egg, right? Normally females undergo bleeding during 5 days of menstrual cycle in general, during which the females, whatever the egg is formed and it is not fertilized, it will be attached to somewhere in the endometrial tissue, and to support that, lot of blood vessels are formed. So if the fertilization fails, the whole thing is scraped off. That is the egg along with the new epithelial tissue and blood vessels which are formed, they all are scraped off. They are shattered. They are broken down. And then whole thing along with that dead egg, then the epithelial tissue will be formed. And the new layer which is formed by the influence of certain hormones are all scraped off and they are released during menstrual bleeding. Menstrual bleeding happens for 5 days. Right? So let us now continue with the hormones and overall structure, what are you have to understand in female reproductive cycle. This is for the menstrual cycle. Okay? So understand this diagram first, what I have drawn. So first is, I have written all the 28 days here, like on scale, right? Day 0, 1, 2, 3, till 28 days I have written there. It is a 28 day cycle. Here, on the 14th day I have written it as ovulation day. Day of ovulation, if it is a 28th day, 28 days reproductive cycle, then it will happen exactly at the 14th day. Sometimes it will change. In some of the females, it may be a 30 day cycle. Some it may be a 25 day cycle. Therefore, accordingly it will change. Right? If it is a 30 day cycle, then 15th to 16th day is considered to be ovulation period. If it is a 28 day cycle, then 14th day or the mid of the complete menstrual cycle is considered to be ovulatory cycle or ovulatory period. So this is about the days I have written in one lower axis. Then coming to the next part, this portion what I have drawn is, these are nothing but the graafian follicle that are still maturing. This is about the changes in the ovary or ovarian follicle. Ovarian follicle is like this. Initially for 5 days nothing is happening. Then after the 5th day, they start developing. Then the ovarian follicle will be maturing with the help of the hormones into graafian follicle. You can see graafian follicle is formed. Then on the 14th day, graafian follicle breaks open and releasing the egg. Egg is coming out along with all the components, whatever it has deposited. This is an egg released. So ovulation period is the time where egg is released. Then after the egg is produced or released, what happens? Egg will be passing through the in the endometrial cavity, will be released in the body cavity. Then the fimbria of the fallopian tube will sweep this egg into the fallopian tube, and as the egg passes in the fallopian tube, its survival rate or its vitality period is 48 hours. Means 2 days it can remain working. Means at that time, if the fertilization happens, it is confirmed pregnancy. Otherwise, no. So this is the egg releasing from the graafian follicle, we call it ovulation. And if it is passed off, what happens to the graafian follicle? The area from where the egg is released, that gets filled up with a kind of thick yellow colored fluid, we call it as corpus luteum or corpus luteum. So what's the function of corpus luteum? This will help in the production of hormone called progesterone. Very important word I am using is progesterone hormone. Actually for ovulation, estrogen is required. That is for the maturation of graafian follicle and release of the egg, the hormone requiring estrogen. And already you remember earlier I discussed that the hormone estrogen is produced from the theca interna layer of the graafian follicle. So here graafian follicle is matured. After that, once egg is released, that area which is vacated by the release of egg will get filled up with the kind of yellow color fluid, and this is called corpus luteum. Right? Corpus luteum. Okay, this corpus luteum is secretory in function. It starts secreting the hormone called progesterone. Then the word progesterone is important for you. What is progesterone? It is called as pregnancy maintaining hormone. Means once progesterone is released from the corpus luteum, you can see the ovarian wall is getting more and more thicker. Right? So once egg is coming out of the graafian follicle, immediately there will be enlargement or secretion of lot of blood vessels and other things will happen in the ovary. This is the uterine wall. The second diagram I have given is the uterine wall. Uterine wall become more and more thick. The expectation is the formation of embryo. The formation of embryo because of pregnancy. Right? So this is because of the production of hormone progesterone. What we call it? It is called the pregnancy maintaining hormone. One more question. What is the function of progesterone? It is a pregnancy maintaining hormone. It helps to prepare the bed of blood vessels in the wall of uterus. Uterus, already you have drawn earlier diagram, right? There is a uterus structure in which the wall is endometrium, which becomes more and more thicker as the ovulation happens. The thickness of the uterus increases only because of the formation of hormone progesterone produced by corpus luteum. So now once the pregnancy fails, first it will be thickening, you can see it is becoming more and more thick. But once pregnancy fails, this corpus luteum start drying up and it becomes dried up structure called corpus albicans. Corpus albicans is a dried up corpus luteum which stops the production of the hormone progesterone. Suppose there is pregnancy, that time the progesterone begins to continuously secrete from the pituitary gland. But right now, as I am talking about a menstrual cycle, there is no pregnancy here. Therefore, the failure pregnancy results in next menstrual cycle. Therefore, this will start disintegrating. This is the disintegration of graafian follicle. And the wall also becomes thinner. Okay? Then at the end, the wall will shuttle off. This is the first 5 days where there will be bleeding happening. This is the wall which is breaking down along with the newly formed tissues and the blood vessels. Whole thing will be cut off and it will be scraped from the uterine wall. That is what we call the menstrual bleeding. So the first phase from here till 5 days, it's the menstrual bleeding. Menstrual bleeding. Okay? Next phase is the development of new graafian follicle from 6th day till the 13th day. We call it as the follicular phase. Okay? Then ovulation phase. Then it is a proliferative phase. From ovulation, the remaining time it is the proliferative phase. So totally there are 3 phases in menstrual cycle. So one by one I am explaining you. This is about the graafian follicle development or the ovarian follicle development. This is about the wall of the uterus, uterine thickening. Uterine thickening, that's a wall. So initially, 1st day to 5th day, when there is bleeding, this will be broken down. So whole thing will be released from this, that is bleeding, first one. Then the graafian follicle is beginning to mature. At that same time, uterine wall start enlarging. And who is helping for this? The hormones, you can see here, pituitary hormones are written here. First is luteinizing hormone, LH hormone. There is FSH, follicle stimulating hormone. Follicle stimulating hormone produced with the anterior part of the pituitary. It helps in maturation of ovarian follicle into graafian follicle. You can see ovarian follicles are becoming graafian follicles. So that is why FSH, follicle stimulating hormone. Then continuation of the LH hormones. See, LH hormone is earlier same, but later suddenly it increases. LH surge will happen at the time after ovulation or at the time of ovulation. Actually, there will be increase in the LH hormone production. This is luteinizing hormone, right? At the 14th week. Then its level goes on decreasing. These are the two pituitary hormones. Then comes ovarian hormones. These are estrogen and progesterone. Estrogen level goes on increasing because it has been ovulation. Ovulation time, estrogen is at the peak. Then once the egg is released, ovulation happens. See, connect these things. Ovulation happens, then estrogen level starts getting down. But progesterone level increases. Why? Because it is the pregnancy limiting hormone. If it is produced, then pregnancy, if it is happening, that continue to increase the thickness of the ovarian wall. So therefore, initially the wall will be thin and it is very thin. And once the menstrual bleeding happens, then the wall start building. It becomes thicker. And if again fertilization fails, it starts decreasing in size, almost in the menstrual cycle. Or menstrual bleeding, it will break down. Okay. This is the menstrual cycle in females. So many things I have explained you. So just concentrate on the drawings. Keep observing. Some more things I'll explain you and draw this diagram to understand. This will not drawing will not be given for the examination, but these are the important points to remember, because it's that not just the dates are important, not just the ovarian follicle is important, not only the uterine wall, not only just hormones, all together it's like a machine, it's working. It's like a remote control. Female's body is like a remote control. As the estrogen start production, because once the bleeding happens, slowly estrogen hormones start increasing, FSH start increasing, they become, their psychological level become boosted up. At the time of ovulation, they'll be very happy and all, right? Once ovulation happens, then slowly the progesterone level starts, that again slowly they'll be decreasing the happiness. And once the menstrual cycle is ahead, when 1 or 2 days again menstrual bleeding is going to happen, that time they'll be more depressed. Therefore, these are all hormone controlled psychology. Female's main psychology is mainly because of the hormone controlling. Therefore, you understand this properly, including females and boys. All of you understand this, because it's not only for the examination, it is required for you to understand how the human body, so magically it is done, how magically all these things work, right? That's a very important thing, and really it's a very beautiful thing about the biology is to learn ourselves. Okay, understand this. And I told you that this is a menstrual bleeding, menstrual phase, then this is a follicular phase or post-menstrual phase, this is a ovulation, this we can call it the proliferating phase. Okay, remember all the three phases, four phases. One is this, second is this, third one is this, fourth one is this. So all the phases and drawing, you remember, very important drawing. And not only just drawing will be asked, you will have to know what is this exactly. What are the small things in this? Okay, done. Okay, so now we have learned about the menstrual cycle, right? I gave the whole of that. Now I will summarize the whole thing to you. So first is, what is menstrual cycle? This is about the cycle involved in female gamete production, which is a 28 days duration, involving the complete structural and physiological changes happening in the reproductive structures. The whole thing is a direction. Then, menstrual cycle is divisible into four important parts or four important phases. First one, so menstrual cycle, I'll give you. Menstrual cycle, imagine this is a cycle I am drawing, right? The first phase, what I'm drawing is around 5 days of bleeding phase. This is the first one. This is the menstrual phase. Then this is about the 5 days. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then remaining is post menstrual phase. Actually, it's a post menstrual phase. Post menstrual phase. Remaining is after post menstrual phase. At particular time, suppose you're talking about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 is a menstrual phase. Then comes the ovulation phase. This is the 13th and 14th day. We call it as the menstrual or the ovulation phase. Ovulatory phase or ovulation phase. Then remaining, whatever you get, this is the post-menstrual phase where graphene follicles are maturing. Okay? This is called the proliferative phase. Right? This till here, it is a proliferative phase. And afterwards, there will be a luteal phase. Like this, we have different phases. Right? So in the first phase, there will be bleeding. Next phase, there will be maturation of graphene follicle. Then is the ovulation phase, then proliferative phase, and the luteal phase, the corpus luteum develops. And after, it is not actually fertilized. Again, in the menstrual phase, it starts bleeding. This is about the complete 4 or 5 sub-steps of the menstrual cycle. Now, what happens in non-primates? See, this menstrual cycle is true with all the primates, like monkeys and chimpanzees and all. Primates, it will happen. But not in the non-primates, like cats, dogs and cow and all, this will not happen. That is called as the estrous phase. Remember, there is something called as estrous cycle they are undergoing. What is estrous cycle? Estrous, the word itself means it's a heat cycle. In those animals which are all non-primates, there will be a heat period will be there, during which only they are actually producing egg. Ovulation happens in the estrous phase. But during that only there will be a breeding season for them. Right? Mostly some of the animals like dogs you have seen, in the whole year they will have one estrous phase only. This is a seasonal breeders they are called. That particular season they breed. Right? After that they will become non-estrous. In the sense they will not be having any breeding time. During estrous cycle period, females produce heat. They will have more sexual anxiety. But afterwards, those period after the breeding season, they will become non-estrous. They will not be producing any heat. They will be normal. Right? That is, in the dogs, they call the single mono-estrous cycle that. In rats and all other things, they will be having around 2 to 3 phases. Polyestrous cycle they undergo. Actually, 2 phases they will undergo. What about the cat, the cow and all? They will have polyestrous cycle. Means in the whole year, anytime they can breed. They will have estrous cycle anytime. But one thing you would have seen, they will not produce bleeding, blood. There will not be any removal of blood from the uterus. Because whatever endometrium tissue is produced during ovulation, it will be absorbed by the uterus itself. They will not undergo menstrual bleeding. That's a very important thing. Therefore, although they are undergoing another cycle, there is no bleeding. But apart from that, other things all will happen. They are all undergoing estrous cycle. And humans and all primates undergo menstrual cycle, where characteristic of menstrual cycle is menstrual bleeding for first few days, around 3 to 5 days. There will be menstrual bleeding. So this is a 5-mark question to distinguish between menstrual cycle and estrous cycle. So already I told you, estrous cycle happens in non-primates and the menstrual cycle happens in primates. Second difference, in estrous cycle there is no uterine bleeding or menstrual bleeding. Estrous cycle it will not happen, but in menstrual cycle there will be first 5 days marked by the bleeding of the uterine tissue, uterine wall and the blood. Third difference is estrous cycle normally results in body increase in the body temperature. they'll get into a heat period. Normally females undergo heat period, and the poly in the menstrual cycle there is no heat period. Then next is about the anxiety. Sexual anxiety is more in females in estrous cycle, but there is nothing like the same in the menstrual cycle. And in estrous cycle, most of the time they will be non-estrous, they will not be very active sexually. But in the menstrual cycle, almost the whole year they will be active sexually. That's about the total differences between estrous cycle and menstrual cycle. It's a final question. So go through this, then I will start with the process of fertilization in humans. Let's continue with the next process, that is about the fertilization. So we have already learned so many things. One is about the structural details of the male and female reproductive system, then gamete formation during the before fertilization, then menstrual cycle, then sperm and the ova. Now we are going to talk about the complete process of fertilization. So in humans, fertilization is internal, that is, it happens within the female genital tract. But what about the other organisms like frogs and other organisms that I explained to you? The fertilization happens outside the female body, we call it as external fertilization. But now we are talking mainly on the external, internal fertilization happening in humans. Right? So coming to the fertilization, it is a union of the male and female, haploid male and female gametes. That is sperm and egg, fertilization of sperm and egg, forming a diploid zygote. The zygote will develop into the young embryo, embryo into egg one. So how do you define fertilization? It is the union of male and female haploid gametes, mainly sperm and the ova, fertilized. They are combining or uniting to form a diploid structure called zygote. Zygote will grow into the embryo, embryo will develop into the egg one. So that's about fertilization. Coming to the humans. In humans, fertilization we can distinguish into different steps. So one by one, let me explain. First thing, it is the release of sperms. Of sperms in the female genital tract. This is the first one. Normally during this process, the number of sperms, probably around 400 billion sperms will be formed. Billion sperms will be formed. These sperms will be released into the female genital tract with force. We call it as the process of ejaculation. At that time, the sperms will enter almost into the cervical area, from vagina to cervix they will get. Then from there, they will start moving haphazardously. Among these, only around 100 sperms only can get the way into female fallopian tube or almost into the uterus. Almost only 100 sperms. Remaining, what happens? What about the remaining sperms among the 400 billion sperms? What happened to them? First is, female's vagina is highly acidic. Most of them, they will die because of acidity of vagina. Second is, the female's cells, whatever the epithelial cells are there, they do phagocytic activity where they attack the sperms and they engulf them and they kill them. Therefore, most of the sperms will be killed, and 50% of sperms are returned back from the vagina to the exterior. Therefore, only 100 sperms can enter into the female genital tract. That's about the first one. This is phase of first phase where there is a release of sperms take place. Second is the movement of sperms in the female genital tract. When they are released, they are moving. Right? Now, I will explain you. Once they enter the female genital tract, they will have to reach the egg. In egg, how they will actually attract to the egg? That is the penetration of the sperm into the egg. Right? Sperm movement towards the egg. This is one kind of discussion point here. In lower organisms like frogs, you are seeing The sperms actually secrete a kind of chemical. They are called as androgamins, and the eggs release the hormone or a chemical called gynogamin. Right? Normally, the egg releasing hormone, the or we call them as gamins. So this happens normally in the frogs. Right? Gamins produced by the egg are called as gynogamins, and the sperms are called as androgamins. Okay? Then gynogamin produced by the egg will have the sperm receptor characters. They receive the sperm. They got spermophilic character they contain. And this gynogamin produced by the egg is called as fertilization. And the sperms, whatever that is, androgamins, these are called anti-fertilizing. Okay? These two attract each other, and once the sperm reach the egg, the two hormones or the chemicals get agglutinated, which helps in sticking of the sperm to the egg. Right? So come to the sperm to the egg. Suppose imagine this is the egg. I am drawing egg. This is the corona radiata, the outermost membrane. Okay? And here the female gametic nucleus. So imagine a lot of sperms enter, because I told 100, maybe only 10 sperms have reached this. This is one sperm, this is another sperm. Like that, many will remain attached to the female gamete. Okay? This is how the sperms are attached to the egg. Now, only one among these will be successful in penetrating the egg. Right? During which, what happens is, the sperm tip will break open and attach to the egg. That we call it as capacitation. Capacitation is a change happening in the sperm during which its tip will break down with the help of sperm lysis and it will attach to the egg. That is capacitation. Now, let's continue. The third step, these are the two steps I told you, sperm reaching the egg is the second step. Third is penetration of sperm. So among so many sperms, one only will be successful in penetration. How it happens? So let me see, let me draw one diagram. This is one diagram where this is egg membrane. There are two membranes already told you. One is ulema and the zona pellucida. Above that there will be corona radiata. Imagine the sperm is over here. This is sperm body and the sperm head. Okay? And here is the female nucleus, sorry, the male nucleus, and this is the tail. It has attached to this. Okay? Once it has attached, its tip, I told you, there will be acrosome containing acrosomal chemicals, we call the lytic enzymes. They produce the sperm lysin and the tip of this sperm will be broken down, releasing this into the surface of the egg. These are actually hyaluronidase and acrosome sperm lysin. Once this is released, the sperm will make the egg membrane smoother. Zona pellucida is broken down. So the next step is the egg will engulf the sperm. It will penetrate along with that egg will produce something like this, so the fertilization cone. Right? This is a fertilization cone where the sperm along with its head and the body will be taken inside. Right? Sperm enters into the egg. This is fertilization cone. Then this is the fertilization happen. Now once the one of the sperm enters, this will be closed. And there will be a new membrane formed by the egg to avoid other sperms to enter. Because only one sperm, polyspermy, is not correct according to biology. Therefore, once one sperm enters, there will be a new layer formed, we call it as a fertilization membrane. Fertilization membrane. Once it's formed, other sperms will not penetrate into this. Next is, this will open up and this will start moving towards the egg. Suppose this is the egg, zona pellucida, the outer membrane. Okay? Sperm has entered into this and it starts moving towards the egg. Right? It will take 180 degree turn and move towards the egg nucleus. Because the female pronucleus is the male pronucleus. they come together and they combine. The fertilization happens. What happens during the fertilization? So next drawing, I draw it here. You can see this. The female and male gametic nuclei are combining. This is called as the mixing up of the male and female pronuclei. All the chromosomes remain attached, and the previously the sperm has brought the centriole, right? That centriole begin to form the spindle fibers. Spindle fibers are formed and the asters are formed and they start division, right? This is the mixing. This is exactly the mixing of the male and female nuclei or fertilization. This becomes a zygote now, right? So step 1, step 2, you can see here. First step, already I told you, first step is release of sperm through ejaculation. Next is sperm moving towards the egg. Normally in other organisms it will be fertilization, anti-fertilization reaction. We call it as a chemotactic reaction or chemotaxis, which actually is not in humans. In humans, this chemotaxis is not there. The sperm move towards the egg by chance. There is no chemical attraction between sperm and the egg. So chemotaxis happens in the lower organisms only, like the frogs, right? Then comes the capacitation happens. Third step is the penetration. We have written here, penetration of the sperm into the egg. Then the fourth step is the entry, that is engulfment and formation of, what do you call it, fertilization cone. This is the fertilization cone. Fertilization cone is formed and sperm is into the cone. Now it will enter and this is a union. This is called amphimixis. Okay. The next step is fourth is formation of fertilization membrane. Fifth step is amphimixis. So all the steps once, let me give you summary. First one is ejaculation. Second is movement of sperm towards the egg. Third one, it is capacitation. In the same one, it is penetration of sperm into the egg. Then fourth one, it is formation of fertilization cone and formation of fertilization membrane by the egg to avoid polyspermia. Last one is amphimixis. Amphimixis is the mixing of the male and female pronuclei forming a zygote, which is diploid in nature, 2n. This is the end of fertilization. But end of the fertilization immediately indicates the starting of the division, that is cleavage. Right? So all the steps you remember, and this is a 5-mark question because almost 5 steps you can draw on this. Write and explain. So these drawings you will have to store somewhere, and because these drawings are here, they are somewhere, just giving explanation will not work. So know the drawings also, then you will understand this. This is a total process of fertilization. But what is this? Chemotaxis happens only in the lower organisms, not in humans. So this is a total story of fertilization in humans. Okay, draw the diagram.